Hey everyone, Dylan here with this week's Game Talk. Our topic this week is how to run a challenging combat encounter without running an unfun or adversarial combat encounter. I'm going to give you five tips that I have found to be invaluable in my tabletop and LARP gaming career. So without further ado, let's get to the tips. Number one, include major story-oriented stakes. So any major super challenging combat should be associated with some sort of important flashpoint, kind of watershed moment in your game's story. You shouldn't include a very hard combat just to have one or as a random encounter, but there should always be some significance behind the reason that your PCs are facing down such a potent adversary. To underscore this, it's very important that you include stakes in these combats that are not simply the lives of the player characters themselves. There are much more interesting consequences for a failure in an extremely pitched battle than the mere death of the player characters. And in fact, when the player character's death is on the line, and it's the only thing on the line, it actually makes the battle kind of boring. It makes it very binary, where either they're going to survive, and if they survive, they're going to get their friends back because they're probably not permanently dead. Depending on what system you're using, it's pretty hard to have people incidentally die outside of a horrifying accident. And in the games where people can die really suddenly, a large section of those games include mechanisms for bringing characters back. So when the characters' lives are the only ones on the line, it can really take away, actually, from the stakes of the encounter. A much more effective way to get your PCs to both invest in the combat more and to remove the potential unfunness of a bunch of people just losing their characters, having their stories end unceremoniously, is to include consequences that are overarching and are not related to the outcome of the combat on the micro level. Say, for example, your major pitched battle is that you and your party of superhero adventurers have to rush in and you have to defeat this lich that is holding a castle while the forces of a kingdom that you've allied yourself are sieging the castle. So the stakes in this case don't actually have to be that the players lose their characters if they lose. Perhaps if they lose, they actually, none of them die. They're dragged out by the soldiers and they're saved. But because they were unable to overcome the lich, the siege fails and hundreds of soldiers die and the kingdom continues to fall under darkness and they don't achieve their objective, which brings a completely different angle to the story. Really what I'm getting at is it needs to be important that they have something to lose that is not just their life. Whether you want them to be able to die or not in the encounter is really not material to the tip here. The important thing is that there's something on the line that is not just their existence. Once you add that, it connects the danger of the fight into the danger of the story, and the stakes become real, the world feels more real, the players will be more invested, and probably less upset if they lose because the story still gets to continue and their characters, you know, still have a part to play until a true and proper conclusion. All right, tip number two, this is more of an encounter design kind of structural tip. Include non-combat objectives in the overall combat. So when you include a non-combat objective, you achieve a number of things, actually, all of which contribute to making the fight more engaging, more enjoyable, and less adversarial. First, you add a level of texture to the outcome of the fight. When there are non-combat objectives, there can be something other than a binary win-loss. So I'll just paint a picture for you. The PCs are trying to protect the ever-frozen cave of eternal purity, and there are four giant ice pillar crystals in the cave of purity. And the enemies are attacking, and they are trying not only to overcome the PCs, but more so to destroy the crystals, because if they destroy the crystals, then the cave will melt, and it'll unbalance the elemental essence of the world and send it spiraling into apocalypse. Okay? So this, A, is a good example of our first one, where there are some stakes outside of the players' lives. But B, there is an objective here that is not simply force A and force B kind of pounding into each other until something happens and some people die. There's a specific terrain tactical objective in play here, and that means that there are outcomes here that are not just the players win and have really no consequences, or the players lose and are totally wrecked. If we take this example and we say there's four crystals, so now we actually have five distinct outcomes, right? We have the best outcome, which is the players protect all four crystals, they win the day, the enemy is defeated, routed, and totally wrecked. There's the worst outcome, which is the enemies destroy all four crystals, the cave melts, and the world is thrust into a dark age. But then we have those middle levels that are kind of intermediary victories, right? So perhaps if only one crystal's destroyed and three crystals survive, the PCs have won, but they have displeased the spirit of the cave, or they failed to live up to some agreement that they've made, or it interacts in some way with the larger story. They take some small consequence for not completely protecting the place, but they still save the world, right? Maybe if two crystals melt, there's a more severe consequence, or they're cursed, or the spirit that protects the cave dies, and now it's more vulnerable in the future. Maybe if they only protect one crystal, the elemental spirits of the world now see that mortals can't be trusted with protection, because they came so close to allowing the world to fall apart and unravel, that now they have to rise up and they need to subjugate the mortal races. You know, whatever, it doesn't really matter what. The important thing is that when you add these non-combat objectives that have multiple moving parts, you add texture to the outcome of the fight. When there's texture, there's more satisfaction and there's less frustration, because binary fights tend to be very frustrating when you're on the wrong side of them. So yeah, add some non-combat objectives. Add some things that you have to achieve that aren't achieved by just making attack rolls and rolling damage dice. Add a ritual that your wizard has to do while they're being protected. And, you know, add artifacts they have to acquire, add commoners that they need to defend. It doesn't really matter what. The important thing is that it adds texture when you add something other than simple force versus force combat to your encounter. Okay, number three, make losing fun. I know that seems like kind of an easier said than done sort of thing, so I'm going to elucidate a little bit. You want to make sure that the energy that you're putting out as the game master is as positive as you want the experience to be for your players, okay? So you definitely don't want to gripe about your bad rolls, because then you're gonna set kind of a precedent for them to gripe about their bad rolls. And what you need to remember as a game master is that you almost always have a significantly smaller emotional investment in the outcome of a fight than your players do. Players, role players, by their nature, become emotionally invested with their characters. It's just the nature of taking on an alternate persona. When you only have that one thing to pilot, it becomes an avatar in the world that it exists in, and it becomes emotionally important. Now, not all players become deeply emotionally invested, but any but the most hardened and heartless wargame players are going to have some level of emotional investment with a character that they've played for many sessions. You don't want to take that away from them, and you also don't want to let your lesser emotional investment in your NPCs get in the way of their emotional investment with their player characters. So you want to be very careful that you're not being snippy, you're not being snipey, that you're not being mean to your players because you're frustrated if an encounter is not going the way you want. You definitely don't want to punish them by making it harder if they happen to do well or come up with some kind of cool plan. Generally, what I'm saying is you want to make sure that you keep on a smiling face, and you want to make sure that you keep a positive energy at the table or at the site, or, you know, whether this is a LARP or a tabletop, this applies equally. You need to be the example of a positive attitude that you want your table to embody. And if you can't do that, you can expect the table to quickly spiral into saltiness and displeasure and adversarial energy. All right, number four, make sure you maintain PC competence. So this is actually not mechanical at all. This is entirely a descriptive and stylistic tip. You need to make sure when you are describing or you are narrating the actions that occur as part of a difficult scenario, that your trick for making the PCs have a higher chance of failure isn't to suddenly make it so that their characters suck. So if one of your characters is a great sword fighter and he is known because he's very specialized in being a great sword fighter, everybody knows he's this really good great sword fighter, he shouldn't suddenly start, you know, swinging wildly and missing and doing things that don't make sense for a character that is a renowned, great sword warrior. You know, if your party has a very stealthy rogue or ranger, the way that you have the description for if they happen to fail their stealth isn't that they do something stupid, it's that the opponent is just so sharp-eyed that even though they're very stealthy, they get noticed. The fundamental idea here is you don't want to take the cool factor of your players and drag that down as a way to pull them down into the pits of loss and challenge. You want to make sure that they keep their cool level. You want to make sure that they keep their narrative factor of awesomeness and excellence and protagonistiness. But you want to take the enemies and bring them up to match or even exceed. So you want to focus on bringing the enemies up more than you want to focus on bringing the players down. And you want to do that by making sure the players still feel cool and competent. Let the players achieve things even if they're losing. It can be very, very valuable. It can really absolve some of the frustration of a fight if you do something to the opponent that really shows. So watch out for no-selling. That's another thing that I would suggest against. That's a wrestling term. No-sell basically means when you take a hit and you just kind of like nothing happens. You see it a lot in like Dragon Ball Z, right? Where like Goku punches a guy in the face and they just like poof, and then they laugh at him. You can do that, but you should avoid doing it excessively because that takes away a lot of the cool factor of the person who's trying to throw the punch. So when a very badass, you know, undead fucking Death Knight is fighting your fighters, you don't want him to just like get hit and not care, get hit and not care, get hit and not care, and then they hit him back, and then you do all this narration about how they're in a ton of pain and it hurts them a bunch. When they hit him, let it do stuff. Let it knock off a piece of his armor. Let them cut off one of his fingers. Let them smash his helmet so they can see the skull underneath that is now slightly fractured. These don't cost you anything in terms of mechanics, and they don't really cost you anything in terms of narration, because the mechanics are still going to be in place and the combat's still going to be challenging. You're just going to use narration to kind of prop up the fun level and make the players feel like they're really in it and they really have a chance, despite potentially losing at the time you're doing these narrations. So always make sure that you're upholding PC competence in all of your narrations and all of your descriptions during a challenging fight, because that's a very easy way to frustrate people and to have the fun kind of go out of their sails, is when they feel like their character is just suddenly and for a reason and not by their choice acting like an idiot. Number five, this is our most mechanically heavy suggestion. Make sure that you don't design the encounter in such a way that the only source of challenge is that everything in the encounter counters everything that the PCs are capable of. So most PCs in any game have a strategy, they have an approach, they have the thing they do, they have their gimmick, right? You don't want to design an encounter that is challenging because it simply simultaneously negates the gimmick of everybody in the party, negates every strategy that they rely on, right? It's okay to have an enemy that negates one or two of these options. But the problem is that if you negate all strategies, you're effectively taking away all the meaning in the player's choices that come up to that point. You're taking away the meaning in their preparation, you're taking away the meaning in how they equip themselves, and you're taking away the meaning in how they've chosen to build their character up in the system that you're playing, if you make it so that all the things they've selected are meaningless because they're just negated. If you negate one or two things, then other people in the party can kind of step up and then they get their turn to shine, and that can be a good way to shift the spotlight around, particularly if you have a table that is mixed between proficiency levels. So like, if you have one player who's very, very good at optimizing the system, or is playing a class that's more powerful than the other people, or a character builder or whatever, it can be a good way to take the spotlight off them during combat a little bit and put it on someone who doesn't get as much attention if you make an enemy that is specifically strong against what that one really strong guy does. But you just have to be careful that you don't structure the encounter so that it shuts everything out, because then the players aren't really getting to have any input. They don't really have any agency in the way the fight plays out if everything they were planning on doing and everything that their characters are good at doing is just wholesale broadcloth wiped off of the option map. So those are our five tips for how to run a challenging encounter without it being too frustrating or adversarial or unfun. What do you guys do to achieve that? What are your strategies for running a hard encounter while still keeping the positive energy and the fun at your table or at your LARP game? Let us know in the comments below. Make sure you like, comment, and subscribe, and share this video if you enjoyed it. You know, pass it around. We're gonna do a new game talk every single Friday on a new topic. We're going to give you more tips on how to run a good game, how to keep your players hooked, how to make sure everybody has a good time, and how to make sure everybody is getting something out of it that is satisfying and fulfilling. So until next time, Dylan here. Thank you for watching, and I will see you next week.